On a similar theme, Shaun Hendy is a registered valuer in Queensland and New South Wales with over 20 years' experience. He's a fellow of the Australian Property Institute and has a postgraduate degree in agricultural economics. Shaun has been a senior rural valuer specialising in broadacre agriculture, farming and grazing enterprises. He has developed a specialisation in water rights and has worked in consultative groups to identify property rights in water and carbon. He's collaborated on several research works in this field for the World Bank and other organisations, and Shaun is also a member of the Carbon Property Rights and Water Property Rights Committees of the Australian Property Institute. So to give his take on these issues, please welcome Shaun Hendy.
Thanks very much, Michael. Thank you very much for the invitation to speak today. It's a topic that you could talk all day on, have a whole conference on, but we'll try and cut it down a little bit shorter. My talk today, I want to sort of give an introduction to where we just see Australian agriculture generally, and then look at the question, okay, what is value? Because value means so much, as so many things to different people. What we see as the influences on land value, and how the urban influences, mining influences, and foreign investment influences affect value. And I'll try and, if we've got time, just finish up on a bit of a case study within a particular region. We've seen agriculture in my professional career change from a supply-driven to a demand-driven fundamental of its operation. So being a supplier of just food and fibre, we've more than provided our needs. However, when you start adding other drivers to that equation, like energy, more recently, and in the future, carbon, it's going to put a lot more pressure on our ability to meet demand and in a way that is efficient for food affordability at the end of the day. Because we have the capacity to produce more than enough food. It is just dependent on the price signals that farmers get as to how much they will produce and what they will produce. So food affordability, and it's in the interests of most governments around the world to be able to provide their populations with cheap, affordable food. If they can't provide cheap, affordable food, anarchy usually occurs. So we see it as we're in a period of opportunity, and there are competing land uses, though. You know, our economies around the world are at various stages. Parts of the world are in recession, other parts are growing, and those areas that are growing, mostly growing as a change in their social, economic, and demographics. So we're seeing an increase in the population around the world where more affluence for and changing food consumption habits, more demand for resources for housing, roads, as businesses and industry grow. So, but what does value mean? To the family farm, you know, their operation focus is on maybe on the property next door. You know, having covered it for years or even generations, they may be prepared to pay more for it than rather miss out on the rare opportunity of attaining it. For the mining company, their real interest is not in the land or the quality of the soil, but rather what is underneath the land that they want to take out and supply to someone else. The foreign investor, they vary. We've got superannuation funds, sovereign funds, private equity investors. So actually, I should qualify that. It's not just foreign investors, it's corporate and institutional investors. So, you know, which there's foreign investors out there operating on their own and also in conjunction with Australian companies. So they make up they have a variety of needs. The super fund likes a nice safe haven with a regular income stream. The sovereign fund, they're motivated in part by food security issues, as well as the potential for sound investment. And private equity investors are sort of considering that, okay, we like the story about agriculture. It's sounds a lot better than it has before. We need some diversification of our investment portfolios, and we're underweight. So they've decided that they are going to participate. These three segments have different return or investment requirements, and therefore where one sees value, another sees that the price is too much. So this gives the point, or raises the point, that the rural property market is comprised of many segments. And our job as valuers is to look at a particular property and determine or assess who we consider will be a most likely buyer for a particular asset. Is it going to be the family farm? Is it going to be the family corporate? Is it going to be an institutional investor? And having an awareness of who is actually in the market at a particular time as well. So, but there are also a number of influences on land values, and these can be categorised into two segments: farm-specific factors and non-farm-specific factors. So the farm-specific factors, we're looking at soil quality, productivity, land use capability, level of development or development potential, climate, and access and proximity to markets. The non-farm related factors, interest rates, currency exchange rates, commodity prices at the farm gate, input costs, government regulation, special interest groups, they all have a play, and I'll demonstrate some of these factors in the case study later. Now, urban influences. Obviously, urban influence is related to population growth, expanding urban areas, encroachment of urban land onto traditional rural activities. So what we're seeing is that those land, and as Tim demonstrated, you could see the difference in values of land associated with size and proximity to urban centres, and as you moved away in a radiating point, values decreased. They represented the values as you move to the large areas and away from the urban centres, they are related more to the commercial rural values as opposed to a lifestyle-related value. Within the areas close to urban centres, like the east coast of Australia, on the eastern side of the Great Dividing Range, is where the majority of our Australian population is. And it's a very small percentage of land, very intensely farmed where it is farmed, with high population densities. Now, these areas are characterised as having intensive agricultural land uses, horticulture, chook, broiler farms, egg farms, hothouses, and those sorts of things, where you're getting a very high output from a very small area of land. Give an indication, looking at value, water use, and intensity. I was involved with a horticultural operation recently where the annual use of water was about 30 megalitres per annum, but their gross annual turnover and sales was $12 million. So we're getting a very intensive use of water and reuse of water through technology. But I suppose as an issue, urbanisation is more of a global issue rather than one that Australia is experiencing everywhere. It's more of a regional or localised issue in Australia, and we're pretty well off. And in some areas, there is a need for better policy to protect rural land. Australia, unfortunately, as we've heard today in several instances, there's no consistency about that approach. Mining. Now, after our last workshop, it would be great to have provided this, just dedicated a whole section, this whole talk on mining. But the effect on mining is twofold. You've got the actual acquisition of land, or the part acquisition of land, and the land use change that occurs as a consequence. So the relocation, the subsequent relocation of the original property owner wanting to re-establish elsewhere has a flow-on or a knock-on effect into the market. Now, the value of land, whether it's acquired by mining, is based on the principles of compensation of, on just terms. So I noticed Tim brought up the case, gave the example of Moray Downs, that where it was reported, you know, the very high value that was negotiated for that property. Under the terms of compensation, the Act allows and requires for factors to be considered that include the value of the land taken, the loss of the value of the land retained, if any retained, severance if it's if it occurs, and the factors of disturbance. Now, within that is a principle of value to the owner. Like Moray Downs, the majority of Moray Downs, if it had a history of cropping, would probably come under the strategic cropping land because of the quality of the Briglow country. It's the value on a per acre basis would appear relatively low, but that's because of the scale of the operation, I think. If that property owner wanted to go into the market and put together an aggregation of a similar size and scale, it would be virtually impossible to do that because of the size of the operation, how it fitted in within his other enterprises, the value it added in terms of his value chain within a breeding, fattening and finishing business that spread across northern Australia and central Queensland. So that's where the premium comes in for that value of the land to the owner. He was able to demonstrate that, and resulted in what was considered by negotiation fair and reasonable compensation. So anyway, just moving on. In many cases, the whole of the land does not occur, and this is occurs quite a lot in the case of coal seam gas. So a coexistence is required. So what we're seeing there, being able to have the miners and the farmers coexist, there are some good examples of it, and there are some examples where it doesn't work so well. And when you've got a multitude of companies occurring, you know, active in the market, that are in the coal seam market, you've got different examples of how things are done. Some are doing it well and some are doing it less well. And there certainly can be an improvement. What we're finding is that there's the extreme of bully boy tactics at one end to a very fair understanding and negotiation of how agreements and coexistence can occur. So we need to be able to move generally more to that other end. And we'd probably find that there'd be less conflict and less issue with regards to the acquisition phase of that process. The other stage, other issues with regards to potential contamination and those things, well, unfortunately, as values, they're out of our control, but they are, I believe, issues that need to be addressed. Example of some coal seam gas well development in near Chinchilla. You can see the wells radiating out with a pond. I understand that there was, with the field day yesterday, which I didn't attend, there was some coal seam gas wells, and the level of water that those wells used is much less than what we're experiencing in Queensland. And I think that just varies depending on the geology and the makeup of the seam. As you can see, there's some little bit more of the scale of the operations. Those white dots are basically all individual wells. You can see a collection point there for water. And I think, you know, that's near Chinchilla, and that might be some of the water that's being beneficially used for irrigation. And that's piped into a scheme that's managed by Sunwater, if I remember correctly. Okay, foreign investment influences. Okay, well, they're being driven by food security. But their presence in the market is creating public concern for foreign direct investment, you know, on the basis of national security and our food security. I don't think we really have to worry about our food security, because we, you know, at the moment we're producing We're exporting 60% of the food that we require on a calorific basis. And if farmers got the price signals, they can produce more than what we need and continue to do so. But the foreign direct foreign investments occurring, food security, changing drivers' demand, talking about biofuels before, added the basis for the needs that, the traditional food and fibre production, changing consumption patterns with our neighbours in China and India, with increasing middle class wealth, they're changing their diets, increasing their meat consumption, which is having adding pressure on grain production, which is feeling the double pressure of providing added production for biofuels. Well, this is an example of our Australia's capability of producing out of food self-sufficiency. So you can see that we're over 200%. US is a bit over 100%. Japan, about 40%. Germany, it's about 80%. And the UK, 60%. We're seen as a good investment. Australia, in which to invest because of our low-risk environment, I suppose. We've got a stable government, generally good land tenure systems, and we're perceived to have a relatively affordable agricultural land. When we start comparing, say, Australia with the US or Australia with Argentina or Australia with the UK, I think there's factors that need to be considered and, you know, maybe a little bit of caution made or taken when those statements are made. Rightio, let's have a look at case study. This is a trend analysis done based in the Moree Plains and the Gwydir Shire. It's a very affluent farming community based in northern New South Wales on the western slopes and plains on the western side of the Great Dividing Range. Is very productive, has some of the most valuable agricultural land in Australia with a strong dry land farming and irrigation history. So it's one of the premium cotton growing regions and for this reason it's probably had a very active property market, all things being considered, over the last few years. Now that blue line is our linear trend line. That's showing where values, the general increase in value trend. So the dark blocks are the volume of sales, number of transactions within that region, and the lighter green line is the actual change in the median sale value, sale prices. Now we've filtered these to exclude sales that are below a certain area, or have a recorded price of $0 or have a gross dollar per hectare basis of less than $50. And it's inclusive, so except for those filtering, it's inclusive of all the rural sales within each of those submarkets, whether it's grazing, dryland farming or irrigation. And for the majority of that period, the irrigation water value is included in those transactions. However, since the establishment of the water register, where the water sales transactions are recorded separately, that's been excluded. So that changes the data on a historical basis. So what we're looking at, this segment has been very active for institutional buyers over the last 4 or 5 years. We've had Prime Ag, Westchester, which by the way, Prime Ag announced yesterday that they sold a number of properties within this region to Westchester. So we're starting to see transactions between the institutions. The Sustainable Ag Fund, Warrikiri bought into the region and towards the end of last year, and the Australian Agricultural Group. So all having made significant investments, and the region is also home to some of Australia's largest family operations, with some assets, or some family assets, ranging from $100 million to $300 million. So we're talking some big dollars. Now, just looking at, I spoke before about property-specific factors and non-property-specific factors driving demand. Now, this history, in terms of the property-specific factors, this region has a history of reliable production, good quality soils, access to water rights, good scale of enterprise, and very good access to supporting infrastructure. However, looking at significant events during that time frame, we can explain in part the fluctuations in the volume of sales and the change in the index on an annual basis there. So in the mid to late 1980s, we had historical high interest rates. So we're seeing property farm values declining significantly. There was low wheat prices in the late 80s and early 90s. We had in the mid 1990s, interest rates eased to much more affordable level, and we see sales volume trends start increasing. We see property values start gradually increasing off their bottom. However, we then have the Asian financial crisis, the removal of the wool price scheme. The mid-1990s also had the world beef glut, and it was pretty dire times. And it was during that period I was actually working as a farm financial counsellor with the Department of Primary Industries, and we were trying to work out and manage farm debt situations, farm profitability, and applying for interest rate subsidies for drought and all sorts of issues. So then in the mid-1990s, we had some fairly significant dollar fluctuations, and that obviously benefited the farm gate prices. In the early 2000s, the continued low Australian dollar and further easing of interest rates. And this is where we started to see values really start turning up, because there's usually a time lag between events occurring and values changing. And it took some time to get over those events of the early 90s with the high interest rates, the beef slump, the low commodity prices generally. So once balance sheets were recapitalised, confidence was restored to the market, we started seeing sales and transactions occurring and values increasing. And we saw what we saw happen in the mini mining boom of early 2000s in central Queensland was that these factors and mining boom was, you know, getting farmers being cashed up were paying and driving values up to levels that were considered unsustainable, and subsequently Tim showed in that Australian pastoral grazing index, you can see values have come back to levels that they're below their peak. And I think we're seeing a little bit of the same happening in some of the farming regions, because even despite the GFC, which occurred, we saw values for grain farms continue to increase in this region. We've seen in that index, we see a dip in values, but that's probably more associated with the grazing side of farming transactions, and because of the water being taken out of the transactions. So farmland values actually continue to increase in that region, while values for grazing land, that were on a high from, very low dollar in the early 2000s, extremely high demand for Australian beef, as the rest of the world experienced BSE and foot and mouth disease, and that opened up a lot of opportunities for Australian producers. But look, going forward, we need to be aware of the influences of the non-farm related as well as the farm related factors. The impacts of urbanisation, the impacts of mining, impacts of foreign investment, they're more as a consequence of the external factors. They're occurring because of the demand and the need for and the consumption of land and for what it can produce. In the short term, values are more impacted by property specific factors and microeconomic factors like farm gate price, seasonal conditions, as opposed to, you know, what's happening with mining or what's happening with foreign investment. The rural property vendor and buyer, their attitudes are changing, and it varies within the property segment in which those buyers are. There's a lot of properties out there that are at institutional grade, and they're asking prices that the institutional investors are saying, well, yeah, we like your property, but you know, we can't acquire a reasonable return for it. So thanks for talking. We'll go somewhere else. And they do. But overall, the investment environment today for agriculture is generally good. So I think there needs to be a little bit of understanding. There's some investors out there who are wanting 15 or 20% returns, and they're just not going to participate. There's other investors out there who are looking at returns of, you know, 5 to 10% on a cash basis plus capital gain, and they're likely to find something that they like. So then we feel that each investment needs to be assessed on its own merits, and we recommend a very sound due diligence process, because there can be a lot of issues picked up or opportunities through that process. Thank you.